I'm going to briefly describe how to use the interactive simulation that models what's often referred to as a Hilsch tube or a vortex tube. And the idea is that we can feed in air. Feed is at higher pressure than atmospheric pressure and room temperature or around room temperature. And we can split the air into a cold gas. So the cold gas is leaving here and the blue is used to indicate lower temperature. Hot gas is leaving here, so red is the other end of the temperature scale in this example. And we can change how much is cold gas and how much is hot gas by changing the slider up here. We also can change the feed pressure, and both of these things will affect how cold the cold gas is, how hot the hot gas is. Now for this particular settings of a feed fraction of, and this is cut off, but this is 0.5. A feed fraction of 0.5 in the cold stream, and of course 0.5 in the hot stream, we can see easily that for a constant heat capacity, which you're using here, we satisfy the first law. Half the gas undergoes a temperature decrease of 42 degrees Kelvin. Half the gas undergoes a temperature increase of 42 degrees Kelvin. So the first law is satisfied. And then here we're calculating the entropy change. The entropy change is positive, meaning the second law is also satisfied. And the main reason the second law is satisfied is that we undergo this pressure drop 4 bar to, we have 1 bar leaving for both cold gas and hot gas. Now the actual values shown here are from experimental data, and we can calculate then a comparison. You might call this isentropic efficiency. If we were to take a gas at 4 bar and 298 and have it undergo adiabatic reversible expansion, then we would get a larger temperature decrease. So that's what the denominator is here. The numerator is the actual temperature decrease, in this case 42 degrees Kelvin. The way the coefficient performs is the product of the isentropic efficiency. It's this multiplied by the fraction of the cold gas, in this case 0.5, and significant figures only giving 2 here. That's why it's not just shown as 0.15 instead of 0.145. So the coefficient of performance basically says if I had 1 mole of gas or 1 kilogram of gas coming in and it went through isentropic expansion, reversible adiabatic expansion, we would cool that kilogram down to a certain temperature. If we compare, in this case, basically it's how much cooling we can obtain. We only have half as much gas that gets cooled down, so the net cooling available would only be 0.15. So that's why I refer to this as coefficient of performance. So let's look at the actual simulation. Well, here's the simulation. And if we decrease the fraction of cold gas, you'll notice the temperature goes down. And we can get a low temperature, 248 Kelvin. Now, if we were to increase the feed pressure, we can get an even colder temperature. So you can see here we're getting a 71 degrees Kelvin drop in temperature. If 20% of the gas is leaving as cold gas and we have a feed pressure 7.8 bar. If I increase the fraction of cold gas and decrease the fraction of hot gas, then the hot gas gets hotter. And let's go to extreme here. Now the hot gas is more than 100 degrees Kelvin hotter than the feed gas, but only 20% of the gas is hot gas. Likewise, you notice the coefficient performance increases and then decreases, so there's some maximum coefficient performance. It's a function of the feed fraction. So the idea of a Hilsch tube is it allows us to obtain cold temperatures without a refrigeration system, sometimes used to cool down cutting tools, for example. and blowing that cold air onto the tool.